Let's consider an example. It's got a special name. It's called the Klein Four-Group. Klein Four-Group is sometimes called K4. Sometimes it's called V. I don't know why. What should we call its elements? Well, it's going to be a group that's going to have four elements. That's why it's called the Klein Four-Group. The identity's got to be one of them if it's going to be a group. Let's go ahead and call that E. What should we call the other three elements? Oh, how about A, B, and C? And what is this group going to, what kind of properties is it going to have? Well, it's going to be a group. It's going to be a group of order four. Is it going to be a cyclic group of order four? No, I'm purposely trying to construct it to be a non-cyclic group of order four. Goal is to make this, make K4 into a non-cyclic group of order four. Obviously, it's got order four if it's got four elements. I am implicitly assuming all these letters represent distinct elements of the group. How in the world could you go about constructing such a group in the abstract if these symbols don't have any meaning? Well, you can define it by its Cayley table. As long as it satisfies the properties of groups, the definition of a group, it will be a group. What kind of condition would be necessary to ensure that it would be a group? Maybe not sufficient. It would have to satisfy Lagrange's theorem. Since the group itself has four elements, each element would have to have an order that divides four. In other words, one, two, or four. But none of them can have order four if I want it to be non-cyclic, right? If any of them had order four, then it would be a cyclic group because that element would be a generator. So all the non-identity elements would have to have order two. E itself is going to be the identity. It's going to have order one. But all the non-identity elements, A, B, and C, would have to have order two. And that means, i.e., when you square them, you get back to the identity, and they themselves are not the identity. A, B, and C are not equal to E. That tells you pretty quickly what the Cayley table starts to look like. Let's go ahead and start to make the Cayley table here. Now, again, these symbols are arbitrary symbols. It's natural to use E for the identity because that's what we've been doing all along. But A, B, and C are arbitrary. I could use other symbols. And in fact, because they're arbitrary, the fact that I'm putting them in alphabetical order once I get past E, doing A, B, and C might seem kind of arbitrary. I mean, why not do B, C, A or C, B, A or something like that? They're arbitrary symbols. So probably that's a hint that they must have sort of some symmetry to them. I want E to be the identity, so I can quickly fill in this part of the table. And all the non-identity elements have order two. I've got E's along the main diagonal. Now let's fill in the rest. What would A times B be? Well, I would hope it makes intuitive sense that it probably better be C. Why? Could you give an argument why it couldn't be A or B or E? Well, I think in the lectures I have mentioned that it is a property of group Cayley tables that each element of the group in the main body of the table will occur exactly once. A has already occurred, E has already occurred. So it's either got to be B or C there. Why couldn't it be B? Why is A times B not equal to B? You could give an argument by contradiction. Just a little tiny proof here. If AB does equal B, what could you conclude? it would have to be the identity. What's a proof of that? Well, effectively, cancellation. B equals EB. Cancel the B's on the right side here. Right cancellation. If you want to remind yourself how to prove that, effectively multiply on the right both side by both sides, on both sides by B inverse, and use the associative property if you want to be extra picky about proving that. You could write all this out and conclude that A equals E, which is a contradiction because A does not equal E. I'm assuming all these letters are distinct group elements. So A times B would have to equal C. And by an analogous argument, B times A would have to equal C as well. It would be an analogous argument. What's A times C? I guess it would have to equal B. Because if A times C, I mean, again, you could give arguments similar to this. If A times C equaled A, that would imply C equals E, and that would be a contradiction. If A times C equaled C, that would imply C, A is the identity, and that would be a contradiction. If A times C equals the identity, that would be a problem as well, because we know, for example, that the identity is A squared. And if you canceled one of the A's, that would imply C is the identity, and that would be a contradiction. Just little tiny arguments I'm giving here. It would have to be B. Yes, each element in the group occurs in this row exactly once. An analogous argument would say C times A equals B as well. This group seems like it's probably abelian. Right, this matrix here is symmetric. Yeah, and what's left over? B times C has to equal A, and C times B also has to equal A for the same kinds of arguments. But again, the roles of A, B, and C probably could be switched around, and we get the same kind of structure to the Cayley table. That's a hint about maybe the group of automorphisms of K4 is something relatively easy to figure out. I'm going to put question mark there. Maybe I should make this a homework problem for Friday. Oh, no, I told you I wouldn't give you a homework problem for Friday. Okay. An unassigned homework problem for Friday to think about if you're interested. It's not too hard. Think about what the group of automorphisms of this would be. And maybe also the group of inner automorphisms. Maybe they're the same. Maybe all the automorphisms are inner automorphisms. I'm not going to say at the moment. Maybe they're not. Good little exercise for you to think about. Actually, another thing to think about related to this is to think about what the group of inner automorphisms of an abelian group is. It's actually fairly easy to figure out for any abelian group. I'll let you think about that, okay? K4 itself, though, is isomorphic to a group we looked at on Monday. K4 itself is isomorphic to the external direct product of Z2 with itself. And in fact, I did mention this on Monday. It's a theorem. You can take it to the bank. If G is a group of order 4, then G is either isomorphic to Z4, it's either cyclic, or G is isomorphic to the external direct product of Z2 with itself, which means G is isomorphic to K4, the Klein four-group. That's a two there, if you can't quite tell. Okay, so this is a theorem you can take to the bank. This is a classification theorem. How many classification theorems do we have then so far now? First classification theorem is that if a group has prime order, it's got to be cyclic, isomorphic to ZP, if P is prime, and is the order of the group. We also mentioned that if G has order 2P, where P is prime, and in fact, it was phrased in terms of the prime being bigger than 2, then it's either cyclic, isomorphic to Z2P, or DP, right? The dihedral group of order 2P. Symmetries of a regular p-gon. We didn't think about the case where p was 2 there because there's no such thing as a 2-gon, right? So this is really the case where p is 2. 4 is 2 times 2. But you can still have the classification theorem. So this is our third classification theorem. Once you get beyond those cases, classification gets harder, okay? But those are the simplest kinds of classification facts.